إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وأحسن الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد الحمد لله الحمد لله ما شاء الله لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله Alhamdulillah, we continue going over the tremendous book that was authored by the Fadilat Shaykh Al-Allama Shaykh Saleh Al-Fawzan Hafidhahullah Ta'ala. That book, which is entitled Tanbihat ala ahkam takhtassu bil mu'minat, the book which is entitled, what translated means, attention to some of the rules and regulations particular to the Muslim women, particular to the Muslim women. Now, we have reached the chapter where the Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he begins to speak about some rules, some ahkam that are particular to beautification of the body of the Muslim woman, yani beautification as relates to her physical person. The Shaykh, he says, في بيان الأحكام تختص بتزين الجسم للمرأة. Explaining some rules that are particular to the beautification or body beautification for the Muslim woman or for the woman. Now, the Shaykh Hafidhahullah Ta'ala, he begins this chapter with something that is very important And something that all of the Muslim women, they have to know and they have to implement. But something that unfortunately has become very commonplace, that is neglected by many of the sisters. The Shaykh, he says, يطلب or يطلب منها أن تفعل من الخصال الفطرة. He said that it is required from her, from the Muslim woman, that she observes some of the characteristics, or better, that she observes the characteristics of fitrah, the characteristics of fitrah. ما يختص بها, those characteristics of the fitrah that are particular unto her, those characteristics of the fitrah that are particular unto her. Na'am. Because we know there are characteristics of fitrah that are specific to the men, that are specific to the men, and we'll come to see what that is shortly. The Shaykh, he says, those characteristics that are particular unto her, وَيَلِيقُ بِهَا, and that they are suitable as relates to her. مِنْ قَصُّ الْأَظَافِرِ, and that is from trimming on and cutting her fingernails. Naam, from cutting and trimming her fingernails. Naam. لأن التقليم أظافر سنة بإجماع أهل العلم. Because cutting of the fingernails, then this is the sunnah by consensus of the people of knowledge. لأنه من خصال الفطرة, because it is from the characteristics of the fitrah, of the natural disposition. Naam, the cutting of the fingernails. Al-Warida fil hadith, that has come inside of the hadith. And that is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Khamsun, there are five. Khamsun min al-fitra, that there are five that is from fitra. Meaning what? Five things, five traits that is from fitra. Right? What are those five things? What are those five things? The first, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions al-khitan. Al-khitan. And that is circumcising. Naam. Circumcision. Circumcision. Circumcision is from fitrah. Is from fitrah. Naam. The second, al-istihdad. Al-istihdad. Naam. And al-istihdad, this is the shaving of the private parts. The shaving of the private parts. And what we understand from this particular word, al-istihdad, is that the shaving of the private parts of the pubic region. Naam. And the pubic region, it just doesn't include the front, but also those hairs that grow around and adjacent to the anus also have to be shaved. Getting back though, what we understand from this word al-istihdad, as the ulama they explain, is that this shaving is done by a sharp object. That we understand, yani, is done by a sharp object, yani, like a razor, naam, a razor blade. Right? This is from fitrah. This is from fitrah. Thirdly, wa taqlimul وتقليم الأظافر, and the clipping of the fingernails. The clipping of the fingernails. نعم. Meaning that the fingernails, they should be trimmed and clipped in, not long. Not long. Having long fingernails, this is not a characteristic that is specific, or this is not a characteristic, rather, of the Muslims. But rather, long fingernails, these and this is from the traits of the kuffar. From the traits of the kuffar. So, this pertains to both men and women. Just like al-istihdad pertains to both men and women. Naam. Likewise, al-khitan pertains to both men and women, circumcision. However, it is incumbent that we mention that this does not include, nor is it similar to genital mutilation. Genital mutilation, that which is practiced in many parts of the world, is not an Islamic tradition. This is not found in the Sharia. This type of genital mutilation and the sewing up of the vaginal area, leaving just a small opening for the passage of urine and the passage of menses and so on and so forth, this is not what is intended and mentioned here. Not to get too much into this particular issue, but in short, as relates to the women, as relates to the men, this is well known. Circumcision, as relates to the men, this is well known. And as the early man, they explained, it is better that it's done, yani, when they are babies. This is more suitable that is done when they're babies. Now, as relates to the women, this issue of circumcision, then what it is the reduction of the clitoris. The reduction of the clitoris. But as Imam Al-Albani, he mentions, because the ulama, they have a discussion on what is the ruling of it. Is it something that is recommended? Is it something that is wajib? So on and so forth. That is obligatory, so on and so forth. Now, Imam Al-Albani, he mentions that the reduction of the clitoris, it only takes place out of necessity. And this is due to those women who they have an extraordinarily long clitoris, which increases her desire to the point where she shows signs of being a nympho. In this case, Imam Al-Albani says, then it is okay and recommended to reduce the size of the clitoris. Because in reduction of the size of such a clitoris, then the woman will be at the same level of normal women. Of normal women who have a normal size clitoris. The Sheikh, he mentions, he says that this is only done out of necessity. Only done out of necessity. And it was done in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he allowed it. So from this standpoint, we know that it's from the Sunnah. But as Imam Al-Albani, he mentioned, only for a necessity. The Imam, he said, and cutting it when the girl is a baby is not recommended. Why? because we don't know if she will need to have it cut later. And if it is such that she does not need to have it cut later, then this will what? It will ruin her. Naam, it will ruin her. So it's only based on necessity, which will happen when she is older, and then it is noticed and it is seen the need for such, then such could be done and it's no problem. Right? But again, this is just the lightening and the slight reduction of the clitoris. This is not removal of the clitoris and then removal of other parts and then the sewing up of... No. That genital mutilation, that is not from Islam. That is not from Islam. And when one looks at the historical record for these type of procedures, and especially and inside of those lands and where in which it is prevalent, they will see that this was something that they were practicing before Islam came to their shores. This is what they were practicing before Islam came to those lands. Naam. So that custom of genital mutilation is a custom of jahiliyyah. This is not what is meant by khitan. This is not what is meant by khitan. Naam. Circumcision. It's not what is meant by khitan. Tayyib. Ala kullin, yani, inshallah ta'ala, that will suffice as mentioned for that. Also, so let's go back now, because we had 1, 2, 3. Al-khitan, circumcision. This is from fitrah, the 5 aspects of fitrah. Now, circumcision, number 1. Number 2, al-istihdad, shaving of the pubic hair. Again, that pubic hair that is in the front, in those regions, yeah, in the front and between the front and the back, and also the shaving of the pubic hair that is in the back, and of that pubic hair that grows around the anus. All of that has to be shaved. Tayyib? All of that has to be shaved. وَالْقَصُّ الشَّارِبِ, and the shortening, right, of the mustache. The shortening of the mustache. This point, or this aspect of fitra, this is particular to the men. This only applies to men. Does not apply to women. It only applies to men. Now, and also, and that's what, number 4. Number 5, وَنَتْفُ الْإِبْطُ, and the plucking, نَتْفُ الْإِبْطِ, the plucking of the armpit hairs. Naam. So also, the hairs in the armpit, they have to be what? They have to be plucked or removed. They have to be removed. طيب? They have to be removed. These are the aspects of fitrah. And this comes in a hadith of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, fima rawahu al-Bukhari wal-Muslim. This comes in a hadith of Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, in that which is collected by both Imam al-Bukhari and Imam Muslim. So this hadith is, and I'll give each of you a second or a few moments to say, what do we call these ahadith? I'll give you an opportunity to answer amongst yourselves a quick second before we say it. This any hadith that is collected by both al-Bukhari and Muslim is called a hadith that is mutafiqun alayh. Naam, a hadith that is agreed upon. Mutafiqun alayh. So whoever said mutafiqun alayh, then you were correct. Whoever said agreed upon, the translation, you were correct. Naam. There comes inside the hadith of Anas bi isnad sahih aw hasan wa natful ibti alla natruku akthara min 40 yawma. And as relates to the removal of the armpit here, but also now we understand from other narrations that he's speaking in general. The removing of the hair that was mentioned, right? Whether that is the hair of the armpits, or that is the pubic hair that has to be shaved, or whether that is the shortening of the mustache for the men. Likewise, the reduction of the fingernails and cutting the fingernails and trimming the fingernails. He mentioned that we will not leave it, that it used to not be left more than 40 days. It used to not be left more than 40 days. And that shows you therein what? That shows you therein the maximum amount of time, yani, between shavings and clippings and so on and so forth. That is the maximum amount of time, and that is 40 days. That's the maximum. This is not to say this is the recommended time. This is not to say that, okay, every 40 days we shave these areas and cut the fingernails. No, it's not to say that. He's just explaining what is the maximal time. What is the maximal time? Now, things may come up, things may happen, whatever the case may be. Someone may be prevented for whatever reasons they may be, right? But don't let it go more than 40 days. But that, again, is not what the mashayikh and the ulama, they recommend as relates to the cutting and plucking and trimming and so on and so forth. Naam. All of these things are tremendously important. Okay? And it's from the fitrah. These are from those things that are particular to the Muslims. This is our way. So it is incumbent that we apply these narrations, and that we groom ourselves appropriately. And this is from the proper grooming, naam, and the proper manner that enters into beautification. So it is incumbent upon all of us that we make sure that we are well groomed. All of us. That we make sure that we are well groomed. And this is from Islam. This is from Islam. This is from the deen of al-Islam. To be well groomed. To be well groomed is from the deen of al-Islam. Now, this is not a justification for those who are obsessive as relates to this particular affair. No. Going overboard, then this is not what we're talking about. That a person spends all day inside of the mirror, now, and so on and so forth. Many, not all day, exaggerating, but long periods of time in front of the mirror, getting ready and things like this, and over obsessing over grooming and beautification. No, we're not saying that. But there has to be a concern. There has to be a concern for the Muslims to make sure they are well groomed, to make sure that they are clean, because this is from Islam. This cleanliness, this is from Islam. And these things that are mentioned here inside of this hadith, the hadith of fitrah, these are things which lend to what? To cleanliness. These are things which enter into cleaning one's body physically. And it's very important that we are constant on these things. Sheikh Fawzan, he said, just like what it comes inside of the hadith, meaning the hadith that was mentioned on those narrations that come bearing this meaning. The Sheikh, he says, وَلِمَا فِي إِزَالَتِهَا. And then he gives some points, and he shows us some of the fawaid, some of the benefits for grooming like this. Naam. So the Shaykh, he mentions, as relates to these benefits, لِمَا فِي إِزَالَتِهَا مِنْ النَّظَافَةِ. Because that which comes inside of the removal of these things from cleanliness. But this is from cleanliness to remove these things. Naam. It is from cleanliness to remove these things. The Shaykh, he says, وَالْحَسُنُ, and this is from good, and this is from beautification, to groom ourselves in this manner, so that the pubic hairs are shaved, and the fingernails are cut, and the mustaches are trimmed and shaved down. Naam. And when it's meant by trimmed and shaved down, meaning that the mustache hair should not cover the lip. The mustache hair, it should not cover the lip for the men. But that mustache hair has, and it should be above the rim of the lip. The rim of the top lip, obviously. Naam. Not the rim of the bottom lip, because that defeats the purpose. The rim of the top lip. Tayyib. Does not cover the lip. Naam. So it has to be above the rim of the what? The top lip. Tayyib. Okay. And the plucking of the armpit hairs. All of this is from cleanliness. All of this is from cleanliness. Naam. And it's from beautification. This is a benefit from it. Also, what shows us the benefit of it is looking at the ill effects of leaving it. The Shaykh, he says, وَمَا فِي بَقَائِهَا, and that which is inside of its leaving, يعني leaving it, يعني طويلة, that which is inside of leaving it long, مِن تَشْوِي وَتَشَبُّه بِالسَّبَاعِ وَبِالسِّبَاعِ وَتِرَاكِ الْأَوْسَاخِ تَحْتَهَا ومنع وصول الماء إلى ما تحتها. أعوذ بالله. The Shaykh, he mentions, he says, and leaving it long, and that which is yani the nasty, dirty effects of leaving it long, is that it's a perversion. It's a perversion. And it's an imitation of wild animals. It's an imitation of wild animals. And it leaves filth and dirtiness under it. Naam. It leaves the filth and the dirtiness under it. Just think about people with long fingernails. How the dirt, it collects under their fingernails. And how with the long fingernails, it makes it very difficult, especially for the women, to properly wash themselves. And with the hair being long, it leaves dirt and filthy residue under it and beneath it. And when it is long and it is thick, it prevents the water from reaching that which is under it. It prevents the water from reaching that which is under it. Naam. وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ وَعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. And even if something from the water reaches it, because the person submerges themselves or what have you, due to this amount of hair and so on and so forth, that dirt, it will not be removed from it. It will not be totally removed. So the dirt got wet and mixed with this and mixed with that, and then you dry off and it's still there. A'udhu billah. So it is important that we abide by these rules and regulations that are taught to all of us, both males and females. Naam. Because this is from the deen of al-Islam. This is from cleanliness. This is from cleanliness. And the smells and the odors that emanate from the individuals who are not observant to the likes of these things is well known. The odors that emanate from the kuffar who they don't abide by these things is well known. For the sisters, all of these things are of extreme importance. Naam. But the Shaykh, Hafidhullah Ta'ala, he highlights on the issue of cutting of the fingernails. Naam. All of them are important, and all of them have to be observed, no doubt. But he wants to highlight on the fingernails. The Shaykh, he mentions بعد المسلمات, some of the Muslim women, يعني بتنينا بتطويل الأظافر. Some of the Muslim women, they are put to test, they are trialed. It's a fitna for them in that they want to have long fingernails. They want to have long fingernails. Naam. And this is not even getting into that which comes along with the long fingernails. Because a person just having a woman, when they have long fingernails, that's not just it. Yani long fingernails for hasp. But then they want to decorate them. They want to get French tips and yani all this type of decorations and this and that. And yani, a'udhu billah. Naam. The problem, there's a lot of problems in that situation. But let's look at some of the problems of that situation. Now, one problem in that situation is that what? When they put on this nail polish is not porous. Now, and yes, they say they have nail polish that is porous and not, yani, water can get under it and this and that. And I'm telling you, don't trust it. Don't trust that. Now, don't trust that. If you want to dye the fingernails, women, with henna, with henna, yani, no problem. That's fine. But this nail polish stuff, even if it says it's porous, and even they have videos and tutorials showing you or whatever, how it's yani, porous and things can... Don't trust that. Don't trust it. Ala kulli hal. They put on nail polish and they decorate and so on and so forth. Now, I mean, in this nail polish, it prevents the water from reaching the fingernail, which means that what? Which means you can't make wudu. There's no wudu. No wudu. Because you prevent the water from reaching the area it has to reach, which is what the enamel of your fingernails. Now, it's not touching your fingernail, it's touching what? It's touching the nail polish on top of it. So this is, yani, of course, it's haram. Now, from this standpoint, of course, it's haram. You're not able to implement a wudu. You can't make wudu. You can't make wudu, then you can't what? You can't pray. If you don't have wudu, your prayer doesn't count. If you don't have wudu, your prayer does not count. Right? Okay. Another problem is that is this not a flat, yani, a showing and of adornments? Long fingernails? Is it not eye-catching and so on and so forth, which will bring the attention, which is the opposite of what? Of the hijab. The hijab is to what? Is to avert attention from a woman's physical beauty. But now you have these long fingernails stretching out from under your sleeve and that. What is this? SubhanAllah. Naam. So from this standpoint, this also is problematic. And it's problematic from the standpoint, as the Shaykh he mentions, تَقْنِيدًا لِلْكَافِرَاتِ, is because they are imitating the kuffar women. They are imitating the kuffar women. And imitation of the kuffar is haram. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, مَنْ تَشَبَّهَ بِقَوْمٍ فَهُوَ مِنْهُمْ. Whoever imitates a people, then he is from them. Minhum, he's from them. Naam. So, it is not permissible for us to imitate the kuffar in those things that are particular to them. And this, bila shak wa bila rayb, is something that is particular to them. Because from the fitrah, from that which we learn in the deen of al-Islam, from that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he taught us and commanded us with, was taqlimul adhafir, and that is to cut and trim the fingernails, to cut and to trim the fingernails. This is from the deen. Okay. The opposite of that, obviously, is not from us. It's not something that is a practice of ours. You understand? It's not a practice of ours. So, obviously, if this practice did not come from us, then it came from other than us. If it not come from us, the Muslims, the people of Islam, then it means it came from who? The people who are not Muslims. The people who, yani, are not upon Islam. So it means that it is a practice that originated and is specific to who? To the kuffar, to the disbelievers. So that which is particular unto them, it is not permissible for us to imitate them in that. Naam. And there are a lot of issues as relates to women's beauty and beautification practices and so on and so forth that fall under this category. Where someone will say, what's the delil Na'am. Then from the adilla, because some issues, there's a lot of dalil yani for it, because a lot of different angles, you find it being haram. Na'am. But in general, all those things, what they have in common is what? Is imitation of the kuffar. It's imitation of the kuffar. So the dalil, why it's not permissible, will be the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Man tashabbaha biqawmin fahuwa minhum." Whoever imitates a people, he is from them. Let's give you some examples. Wearing a white wedding dress on your wedding. Wearing a white wedding dress, ma'am. Or let's broaden it. Wearing that type of wedding dress, like the kuffar they wear, you understand? On the wedding. Not to say you can't dress up and look nice for your wedding. No, you're not saying that. But I'm saying wearing that white wedding dress, that style, that manner of dress, this is something that is particular to the kuffar. This is not from the practices of the people of al-Islam. It is something that is not only particular to the kuffar, but it's something that has its origin and its links inside of their religion. It has origin, and the link is where? Is inside of their deen. Their deen. They wear the color white because it has a significance. And that significance was that white was only worn by virgin brides. This is why it was white. White was only worn by virgin brides. Now, so at a time where a lot of the kuffar, the Christians in particular, who had more of a sense of morality, a large percentage of people who were married were virgins. Now, a large percentage of people who were married were virgins. And this is, mind you, talking about those Christians who they didn't believe in divorce. Those who were from the Catholic tradition, who didn't believe in divorce and thought divorce was not permissible and so on and so forth. So you find that once they got married, that was it. You understand? So the vast majority of the people who got married was what? Was virgins. Was virgins. Of course, you always had scandals here and there, right? But the vast majority of them was virgins. Hence, this is why they always was dressed in white. This is something that emanates from them, and it has a significance amongst them. So why would anyone believe that what this has any link in Islam? It's not. This is not from us. This is from them. It's from them. But yeah. Likewise, these weird body piercings and modifications, piercings, ma'am, this is that which is from the kuffar. This is not that which is known amongst the Muslims. And what I mean by that, I mean like getting piercings of your eyebrow, right? Piercings of your cheek, piercings of your lip, so on and so forth. These are not piercings that are known to the Muslims. Now, and then of course the piercing of the private parts, then this is haram. No one is allowed to see the private parts except for the spouse. Now, no one's allowed to see the private parts except for the spouse. And even if the spouse was the one to do this type of, mutilation, it's haram. Why? Because this is not from us. This is from the kuffar. This is from the kuffar. وَقِسْ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. And use that as a measuring stick and apply it to that which is similar to it. But عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. That having these long fingernails, decorating them, putting holes in them so you can put like a fingernail ring or whatever that they be putting in it. This is haram. This is from the ways of the kuffar. So it's incumbent and it's important that our Muslim sisters, they are mindful of this. And that they keep their fingernails trimmed and they keep them low. Likewise for the brothers. It is incumbent that the brothers, they keep their fingernails low. And they keep them down the size. And this is very important. Even for the brothers, it's very important. Also, this comes from the imitating of those who are ignorant about the sunnah. Naam, bujuhala. Those who are ignorant about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because anyone who they know of this hadith that is mutafiqun alayhi from the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and likewise the hadith of Anas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, then he would know that, or she would know that, having long fingernails is not from the sunnah. It's not from the sunnah. Naam. وَيَسِنُّ لِلْمَرْأَةِ. And also, it is the sunnah for the women, إِزَالَةُ الشَّعْرِ الْإِبْطَيْنِ وَالْعَيْنَةِ عَمَلًا بِالْحَدِيثِ الْوَارِدِ فِي ذَلِكَ. Also, the Shaykh, he mentions, and it is from the sunnah for the woman to remove her armpit hairs from both armpits. Removing of the armpit hair, now the plucking of the armpit hair, it means from both of them. From both of them, and it has to be stressed so that it is abundantly clear, so that no one thinks if I remove the hair from the right one, then I remove armpit hair, so then that constitutes, right? And then the left one is a'udhu billah. No. Remove the armpit hair from both of them. Now remove both hair. Remove the hair from both armpits. Remove the hair from both armpits. And also the removal of the pubic hair. The removal of the pubic hair. Naam. The Shaykh says, and this is implementing and acting according to the hadith. This is implementing and acting according to the hadith that has come as relates to that. And that is the hadith that is mutafiqun alayh, and it was narrated. And I'm going to give you time for those who are listening. I'm going to give you time to say it. The hadith is mutafiqun alayh. And a hadith that is mutafiqun alayh, it's a hadith that what has been agreed upon by who? Now, those who said al-Bukhari and Muslim, then you are correct. And this hadith was narrated by who? I'm going to pause and give you time to say it. It was narrated by? Naam. Those who said? Abu Hurairah. You were correct. Likewise, those who may have said? Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhuma. Then you are also correct. We'll take either of those. No problem. But the one that we were looking for was the particular narration that was mentioned from Bukhari and Muslim, and that was from Abu Hurairah. That was from Abu Hurairah. Naam. In that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us that there are five things that are from fitrah. There are five things that are from fitrah. Naam. And we want the order of the hadith. The five things that are from fitrah, number one, and I'm going to pause after each, giving you time to say it. The first one was what? It was? Naam. Khitan. Circumcision. That's the first. The second one, it was? The second one, it was? Al-istihdad. And that is the shaving of the pubic hair. The third one was? Taqlimul Awafir. Cutting and trimming of the fingernails. The fourth one is? It is the trimming of the mustache. The shortening and trimming of the mustache. And the fifth, it is the plucking of the armpit hairs. The plucking of the armpit hairs. And in the hadith of Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentioned that the longest period of time that can go between groomings is how long? How long is it? How many days? 20 days? Is it 20? No, not 20. 10 days? Is it 10 days? No, not 10 days. 30 days, a month, right? No, not a month. How long is it? It's 40 days. How long? 40 days. 40. Now, من 40 يوما. 40 days. From 40 days. طيب. Al-Allama, Al-Fawzan, he mentions, because remember we said that the longest period, as Anas, radiallahu ta'ala, he mentioned, la natruku akthar min 40 yawma, we didn't leave it for more than 40 days. Now, so me, 40 days is the cutoff, that's the longest. But I mentioned to you before, this is not what's recommended though. This is not what's recommended. That's just showing you the longest time. This is not him giving you a recommendation to do it every 40 days. No. He's just telling you the longest period of time is 40 days. That's the longest period of time. However, the what is recommended, Shaykh Khuzani says, wal ahsan, and that which is better, right? That which is better, an yakuna dhalika kullu usbu', that is every week. What's better is that is every week. وَلَا يُتْرَكُ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ 40 يَوْمًا, and it's not to be left for more than 40 days. Now, it's not to be left for more than 40 days. However, what's better is that what? Is that is done weekly. It's done weekly. Okay? And for those people who their hair grows very fast, they can do it as they see fit. It's fine. If their hair grows very fast, because some people their hair grows faster than others. If it's a person where their hair grows very fast, then they can do it as they see fit. That's fine. Now, but at least every week they should do it. At least every week they should groom themselves and to make sure that they are properly groomed. Now, make sure they are properly groomed. And there are many benefits from being properly groomed and making sure we are properly groomed. Now, from those benefits is the cleanliness. From those benefits is the beautification. And especially those who are married. Now, both males and females. As you mentioned, I mentioned males first. Because maybe men need a little more push in this direction. And that is to make sure that they are groomed well. That they are properly groomed. Na'am? That they are properly groomed. And they take some time to beautify themselves. Na'am? Yes, brothers. Brothers have to beautify themselves. So the brothers, they need to make sure that they need to comb their hair. They need to grease and oil their hair. Likewise, their skin. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he encouraged us to use olive oil. He called it a blessed oil. For topical utilization and also to ingest it, to eat it. Naam. So, this is good, brothers. You too, you need to groom yourselves. Likewise, to grease not just your hair and your scalp, but your beards. To make sure you take care of your beards. To grease them. To perfume them. Okay? Putting yani عطر, oils, yani بخور. Na'am, it's fine. Brothers need to make sure that they're doing this. And that you comb your hair. Comb your hair. Which means comb your beards. Don't be walking around your beard looking all crazy. Right? Like you got an animal on your chin. Comb your beards. This is important. It's important, brothers. You have to make sure you look good for your wives. Just like you want them to look good for you, You got to make sure you look good and you smell good for them. Okay? And the women, nah, enough said. You two have to make sure you look good for each other. And that is what? That is from what will have help to have a good marriage. Naam. Also, a benefit in doing this, right? Of course, is that you escape from all of the dirty things that come from not doing it, right? But also a benefit, and I want you to think about this too, right? Also a benefit in doing this is that if all of this stuff is done properly, you make it easy. You make it easy on your brothers and your sisters who wash your body once you have died. You make it easy upon them, okay? So it's important that as Muslims, we do these things from all of these things that were mentioned, but also in preparation for death. In preparation for death. So that we make sure that, look, we ready to die anytime. And that's how we should be living our lives. That we ready to die anytime. Okay? We should be living our lives in a manner that we ready to die anytime. This not to say we have a death wish. No. No, not saying that. Okay? Because the longer a Muslim lives, the better. The longer a Muslim lives, the better. Because he has more time to collect more good deeds, to do more good deeds. Okay? So the longer life is better for the Muslim. So no Muslim should be wanting to die. No. What I mean by that you're ready to die, prepared for death, is that you live your life in such a state that when the angel come to you, na'am, you're not from those who, wait, I need more time. I need to do this. I need to do that. I need to improve this and improve that. No. Live your life in a manner where you're striving and you live in such a manner that what you do in your lifestyle will not be detrimental to you when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Naam. Will not be detrimental when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You understand? You die, of course, we're all going to regret the times that we didn't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we had the opportunity. Everyone is going to be saddened over that time that they didn't remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more and obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I'm saying is, we should make sure that when death comes to us, that's our only regret, is that we didn't have more time to do more. Not, we ain't even get started yet. We need time to get started. We need time to turn our life around. We need time to become righteous. No, because when the angel comes to take your soul, your time is up. There's no more time. If you didn't do it before now, you ain't gonna do it now. It's over. It's over. Ain't nobody coming back. Give you more time, taking you now. It's done. So we need to live our lives ready for that moment. So we need to increase in tawbah, asking Allah to forgive us. Increase in doing good deeds. Increase in supplicating to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam bin Baz, rahimahullah ta'ala, he was always striving to get good and preparing for death. Imam bin Baz, rahmatullah alayh, Sheikh Muhammad Bazmoul, he mentions that his Sheikh Wasiullah, hafidhahumullah ta'ala, he mentions that Imam bin Baz, one time at a seminar, they were asking him questions in the question and answer session. And when the people they was asking questions, so now this time the people is asking questions. The sheikh, he's not talking. The people are asking questions. So it's an opportunity of quiet time for the sheikh. That at this time, the sheikh, Nam, he was listening to what they were saying and the question that they was asking. But the sheikh, he said, you can hear for the one who was close to him and put his ear close to the sheikh's face. You can hear the sheikh saying, subhanallah, subhanallah. La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, subhanallah, alhamdulillah. Na'am? You heard the sheikh, what? Making dhikr. Praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Making dhikr. Na'am? Saying subhanallah Alhamdulillah. La ilaha illallah. Allahu Akbar. The Shaykh didn't leave no opportunity except that he tried to take advantage of it. Shaykh Bazmouli mentions that Shaykh Wasiyallah, Hafidhahum Allah Ta'ala, he mentioned, he said, you see, Shaykh bin Baz, he was ready to die at any time. He was ready to die any time. He was preparing because he knew death was coming. He's preparing, trying to get all the good deeds he can possibly get because he knows death is coming. Let me give you an example. Okay? If someone told you, listen, I'm going to let you go on a shopping spree, whatever your favorite store is, you know, whatever. Okay? Whatever. Person like technology, so whatever technology store, right? Person like, I don't know, arts and craft, whatever, arts and craft. Well, yeah, whatever. Whatever's your thing, okay? That's halal, of course. If it's haram, you know, fair Allah. But I mean, that's halal. But if someone came to you and they gave you like a real big cart, I mean like a huge cart, right? And they said to you, we're going to give you whatever period of time. Run through the store, grab everything you want. And when that time is over, it's done. Is there anybody from amongst us? Now I'm just asking the question, okay? Is there anybody from amongst us who's going to waste time? Who's going to waste time? Who's going to sit around and say, okay, well, and you know, I'm going to sit here and talk to you, all this and that, and lollygag with you for a quick second, and then go talk to the, you know, whatever, and lollygag with them for a quick second. Is there anyone that would do that? Anyone that would say, okay, let me just sit down for a minute, take a breath, you know? Let me just sit here for a few minutes and check it out. No. What would the person do? As soon as they say, go, running through the store, grabbing stuff, throwing stuff in the cart, doing this, doing that, right? Why? Because they want to capitalize because they know their time period is limited. They know they don't got forever. So they want to capitalize, get as much stuff as possible. You understand what I'm saying? They want to get as much stuff as possible. But if this is the situation when it comes to technology, okay, you into computers and you into hard drives and, you know, tablets and phones and you know, so you running through grabbing all the nice stuff, all the neat gadgets and, you know, smart watch and this and that and yeah. That's important to you, right? But in retrospect and in reality, how important really is it to you? But if you was given a short period of time, you can go through, get anything you want, you will run through and get as much as you possibly can. As much as that car can carry, as much as your arm can hold. People that run really fast and even ask, yo, can I just, you know, get another cart, fill a cart, bring it here, get another cart, leave it here, get another cart, fill that one, bring it back. Yani, can I just keep filling carts and coming back and back and back and back? You're trying to take full advantage of your time. Okay? Wait, why? Because your time is limited. Now let me ask you, son. Is any one of us here forever? We gonna be in this dunya forever? We got forever to do good deeds. We got forever to pray. We got forever to fast. We got forever to make dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We got forever to seek knowledge. We got forever to read the Quran. And everybody, of course, is gonna say, well, of course not. All right, so why are we acting like that? Why we act like we got forever? Why do we act like we have forever? Everybody procrastinating. Oh, I'll do it tomorrow. Tomorrow only benefits the ones who don't die today. Tomorrow only benefits those who don't die tonight. Tomorrow only benefits those who don't die before tomorrow. But if you die before tomorrow, then what benefit is tomorrow for you? None. So when it comes to the Akhirah, you better do what you got to do right now. You better do what you got to do right now. Okay? So, from those things, getting back now, I digress. Getting back now to the beautification, is that what? Is that by doing these things, we are prepared and we are ready to die. We are ready to make it easy for our brothers, for the men and our sisters, for the women, to what? To wash our bodies after we have died. Make it easy for them. Because we are properly groomed. That's just something I want everyone to let marinate, inshallah ta'ala. And then the Shaykh, he goes on to the next point, which is linked to the issue of women cutting their hair, the hair on their heads. Naam. But bithnillahi ta'ala, we will save that till the next class, as there is quite some lengthy discussion on that, and we want to give it its proper time and its due. So we'll save that to the next class. فنتوقف هنا ونكتفي بهذا القدر وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وجزاكم الله خيراً.